Yannick, welcome to the Schaffhausen Jazz Festival.
Thanks.
You told me you arrived from Lausanne, although you're living in Berlin, you're teaching in Lausanne. Now
right.
You're somewhere in between in Schaffhausen, and you're here piano solo. You play a solo set this evening, and this is your third album as a solo pianist. And I went through the track list and I saw you combine compositions of your own, but then also compositions of jazz musicians like Chick Corea, mm-hmm. and then there is some Schumann and Johann Sebastian Bach.
Exactly. Yeah.
When did you start to combine these three epochs of music?
I don't care about where the music is coming from. I'm just, when I get touched by music, it could be a pop song or a classical leader or a jazz tune or anything. If it's touching me and I get moved by the music, it's like a need to try to do something with that. But sometimes it takes time to get rid of the original one. Some sort of having enough time to forget the original one, because when you're touching like Bach or Schumann, it's like you basically you don't want to destroy it. If you love it. So it takes a long process to forget the original and to transform into something that sounds like me, like the music I like to do.
That's really what I want to talk about, like how do you make Bach your own? I mean, for some musicians like Johann Sebastian Bach, this is like the holy grail of music.
For me too. It's for sure.
And when you're dealing with Johann Sebastian Bach and this kind of music that is so special also in music history, and then you are trying to make it your own, mm-hmm. what is the process?
It's once you decide to try to make an arrangement of this particular piece, actually the Sarabande in D minor, it's better to not listen to it anymore. Because I don't think you can adorate something and having the distance necessary to do something about this. So I didn't spend too much time studying the score or listen to the audio, but just, you know, like memories are morphing or transforming. So if you wait enough time, the music starts to metamorphosing somehow, and yeah, for that one is the most difficult one because I really love Bach, and for me it's something you should never touch. Or I mean, basically, every note you change, you destroy something. So it really needs a long distance, but also this piece is really really special because the first time I listened to it, I was pinching myself, saying, that's Bach, really? Because the melody, the harmony is really surprising and modern somehow. So it was like a coup de foudre, like we say in French, like a shock. Oh, this piece, I have to do something with that. But I could not, I try like the Art of Fugue or something, or the aria from Goldberg Variations, mm-hmm. but it's too, I don't know, it's not the same language probably, and this piece has a really weird shape, melodically speaking, so it's probably a bit closer to jazz music than the rest he wrote.
That's what actually many musicians, especially jazz musicians, say, that Bach is somehow close to jazz music,
yeah.
And like Bach is one of the predecessors who led to bebop in the end.
Somehow, yeah.
And can you describe this for the audience? What is it that Bach and bebop are somehow linked?
I think the use of ornamentation to decorate the melody, it's kind of close to what we can hear in bebop. And also, it's just before classicism, so there is still some sort of freedom to make ornamentation. They are, most of the time, they are not written on the score. So there is a biggest part than the performer can bring to the piece, and not only trying to not betray the score. There is a bit of freedom, and also Bach is really coming at the end of this Baroque movement, and he try out a lot of things. He gets to the end of every kind of possibility a 12-tone music can offer. And in that way, I think it's precursor to what's coming next. When you listen to Mozart after Bach, mm-hmm. it's some parameters are maybe a bit more discrete about what you can do with the notes and keys and chords. It's more gentle, it's more polite. But Bach is crazy somehow, so I think we can hear that still now.
Do you also get inspiration from Bach for your own compositions? So when we listen to your concert today, will there the influence of Bach, will it be limited to the pieces from Bach you play, or is it like all over a little bit?
Yeah, I won't play a Bach piece tonight because I have a short set. And but yeah, definitely I'm fascinating, and that's why I'm working on it for many years. It's a polyphonic improvisation, like improvising many melody at the same mm-hmm. times, and that's of course coming from listening to Bach a lot. So yeah, this contrapunctus way of thinking music, it's really fascinating me, and it's good because jazz musicians, we are a bit like maybe too much vertical thinking, like chords and melody, like two blocks. But for the Bach or any classical music, it's more like many melodies that making chords if you make a snapshot. So I'm trying to reach that kind of a way of making music.
We have this album here, Yannick Dele, the Live Monotypes. It's like, it's a double CD. It's also, for me, it looks like it's a double album.
Yeah.
What is the story behind this album?
So the first album, the live one, it's a concert I made in a Beethoven house in Bonn, which is an amazing place for piano. It's basically a whole build around the piano, for the piano. So the sound is really great, and I was invited to play there by the German radio, Deutschlandfunk. And they recorded the concert, and I was happy with the result. And they was okay to publish it. But I wait a little bit before publish the album, and then I really dig into the Echtzeit music scene in Berlin, which is people making free music, but not in the free jazz way. It's more classical music, people coming from contemporary or classical music and improvising totally free music. And I spent a lot of time with those people in Berlin, and it started growing in me the need to play totally improvised music without any pre-thought. And I felt weird to release this album because I felt now I'm maybe on another path to music more improvised. So they agreed that I come back to the same hall, the same venue, but without public this time, and I just record 3 days of whatever comes to my mind, and then I choose the best, I hope, part of it. So the connection between the two things are clearly the venue, this Beethoven house in Bonn, and also the sort of evolution you can maybe hear between the concert and the more free improvised music.
This is your third album, solo. I mean, you have other pieces. You told me today you just come from a recording session with a larger group, with a quartet or
string quartet and piano.
With a string quartet and piano, so you were five people there. But as a solo musician, this is your third album. Mm-hmm. What is the development, or you mentioned the evolution from your first solo album to this double album?
That's really hard to explain because I think my first experience in piano solo was at the end of my studies. I had to perform a solo set for the examination, and I discovered at that moment that, oh, it's so cooler to be on stage alone. The connection with the audience is so much intense and deep. And for the beginning, when I record the first album, for me it was clear that that project will be my main band, actually. And since then, I just try to develop, improve, but also follow what I wanted to do. It feels really natural for me. Of course, for pianists, it's easier to make a solo music. But for me, it's no question. I just follow some instinct that I feel for making more piano solo music.
You have future plans?
It might be another live release. I'm not sure yet, so I don't want to talk about this. But it could be another one which we recorded in a festival in Switzerland. Mm.
So now let's change the topic or the perspective a little bit. You play worldwide, like Hong Kong, Beirut, Sao Paulo, so all the continents. Mm-hmm. That's really impressive. And when I saw this, I thought, like, what is it that makes your music work everywhere?
Well, that's probably not me to respond to that question. The band, when I play in all country, it was actually a really special band with seven pianos on stage called Piano 7. So it was a huge machine, like a spectacular thing, and we played huge theater. I wrote also music for that thing, but I like to think like music is such a banal thing to say, but there is no boundaries, and when you play music, you don't address to the brain of people, actually. You address to something deeper or higher, or I don't know, but it's nothing to do with the language you speak or the culture you have. For me, at least, for how I see music, I try to reach something that it's in everyone. It's super basic to say, but I really believe in that. And when you play a piano solo in front of people, you can feel that it's a universal language, whatever, in which country you are.
In Schaffhausen, there are always the Schaffhausen Jazzgespräche. And this year, the topic is around like climate change and like global challenges we face at the moment. And so my question there is always, as artists, what is the role we have? And now you mentioned that music is something universal, mm-hmm. or it has universal components in music. And do you think there are things that come from art or from culture that speak to something more deep into people than only to the brain? Do you think there is something we could use to adapt to work against these global challenges?
I think individually we have to do something, everyone. And I'm certainly not the best example because I live in Berlin and I teach in Lausanne, so my CO2 contribution is massive, and it's problematic for me. But I have to say, I totally respect people using art or music for political purpose. I don't feel that way for me, because for me, music and art, it's above or beside those questions. But I deeply respect people like songwriter with a deep lyrics, try to change the world. I don't like to use music or art to anything else that's music or art, to change opinions or to help any cause, because I deeply care about music is enough for what it is, you know what I mean? There is no need to put a political label or a great fight. I think music deserves to stay this weird magical thing we don't understand, why suddenly I have my hairs like this, or why I'm crying, or why I want to dance when I hear music and there is no words that I can understand. I deeply want to keep the music that way, something we cannot really understand, and something which is deeply abstract and magical for me. So I don't want to put any political stuff on top of that.
Yannick, merci beaucoup.
Merci à toi.
And we're looking forward for the magic you're going to share with us now with this concert tonight.
Thank you very much.